To demonstrate the use of collections, I'm going to create a console application that simulates a shopping cart. First, let's create a class called item. And these items will be anything that you might add to the shopping cart. I'll give it a couple of simple properties, a title and a price. Just to make it easier to display, let's override the toString standard method. And we'll just show the title if somebody calls toString. Actually, let's show both the title and the price. Now I'll create a constructor that defines both the title and the price. That's enough for my item, but of course, we should be more specific here. If somebody is buying a book, we should have a separate class for a book because books have unique properties such as an author. If somebody's buying a CD, we should be able to define the artist. I'm going to derive classes for both books and CDs from the item class. And the reason for doing that will be more obvious as we go along, but basically it allows us to treat both books and CDs as the same class because we'll be able to deal with the common base class and the properties contained in the common base class. So for the book, I'll define an ISBN, which is just a code that uniquely defines a book. And I'll also give it a custom constructor that not only defines the title and price that are in the base class, but also the ISBN. Little copy paste. And I will quickly also define a CD also based on the item class. To do that, I'm also going to need to define a default constructor for item, of course. That should do it. Now I'll be able to get into the meat of the application, which involves adding instances of books or CDs to an array and then displaying that array or sorting that array. So the first class I'll work with is ArrayList. That requires me to add the system.collections namespace. And here I'll define an instance of ArrayList. And I will simply go through and manually add a few different items. You'll see this wouldn't be efficient to do it in the real world, but for the sake of the example, it'll keep it simple. We'll just call the add method, and then I will create a new instance of each item. I'll use one of my books, the Windows Vista Resource Kit, and call the book constructor, which requires typing the ISBN. No, I don't have this memorized. And the Windows 7 Resource Kit. And to demonstrate that we can add different types of objects to a single ArrayList, I'm going to create a couple of CDs too. I'll use the standard Microsoft fictitious names because I don't actually have any CDs released. With the items ArrayList filled with different types of items, I'll create a method that simply displays them to the console. I'll call it Show Shopping Cart. Notice that it takes an instance of ArrayList, so it doesn't care about the contents of the ArrayList. It's simply an instance of ArrayList. I'll call the for each loop to iterate through the contents of the ArrayList. And Notice that I don't need to say for each book or for each CD in array in the array list. I simply need to use the base class that both those classes have in common. Then I'll be able to call any of the properties that would be available in the base class. I'm just going to be displaying them to the console, so a simple toString will suffice. I'm going to add one more line to the main method to pause the console so it doesn't disappear when I run it. And of course, I need to call the show shopping cart method. This is ready to run, and we'll be able to view the contents of the shopping cart. Notice that the sequence is exactly the sequence that I ordered them in. They're not sorted in any way. We'll go and do that next. So, ArrayList has a method called sort that we can call. Let's just do that and see what happens. We get an error message saying that it couldn't compare two elements of the array. Now, if you want to sort something, you have to implement the iComparable interface. So let's go and do that for the item class now. To do that, we will just inherit the iComparable interface. C# will make this easy for us to implement the interface. Down here, it added the structure for the method. I just need to overwrite the default exception that it throws. So compareTo is really, really easy to implement. All compareTo wants to know is which of two instances comes first if you sort them. So we could sort them by price or title. For now, let's make the default sorting method by title. So I'll do this all in one line. All I need to do is to access the title property and then call its default comparer. So title is a string, and string has the compareTo method already implemented. So I'm just going to call that and compare it to the object that is being compared to, and I will let the string implementation figure out which of those two comes first. So you can see what I've done here is there's an existing instance. The compareTo method accepts an object class, which is going to be an object of the same type. And as a return value, I need to return whichever one comes first. So I'm calling the title properties implementation of compareTo and passing it the exact same parameter that I was passed, but cast to an item and then the title property of that object. And it will return whichever one comes first, and then my return string passes that on up to the original caller. This will be enough for the array.sort method to work. And as you can see here, Contoso music comes first because it starts with a C followed by Fabrican music. In a shopping cart, some people want to see things sorted by price. That gets a little bit more complicated. If you want to use something other than the default comparer, you can create your own iComparer implementation. So let's do that now to allow people to sort things in the items array by price. We'll call it sort item by price, not iComparable. We want iComparer. Notice that this is a standalone class. I'll implement the interface here. Now, the compare method is not an instance of the class that's being compared. It's its own class. So it actually receives two different objects. And as before, we need to return the one that should come first. We're returning an integer, that indicates which of the two came first. The implementation is still going to be pretty easy though. First, I'm just going to cast the two objects to the correct type, which is item. And then I'm going to, once again, call the implementation from the base property class. So in my return, I'm simply going to access price, property for each, and call the compareTo method. I'm also going to alter one of these prices. Let's say that maybe there's a sale on the Windows Vista resource kit, so we're going to lower the price of that. And the sort method takes you can pass it an iComparer instance. So I will pass it the sort item by price class. I believe first I need to create an instance of it. And here it is. You can see that it correctly sorted the ArrayList by price. So the ArrayList class is my favorite class for just general array usage, but sometimes you have more specialized uses. Let's, for example, say you were creating an array that would keep track of orders that different customers had placed so that you could ship them in order from the first received to the last received. The .NET framework provides the queue class to do that. I'm going to remove my ArrayList implementation and replace it with a queue. Otherwise, it basically works the same. Queue doesn't have an add method. Instead, it has an queue. It does exactly the same thing as that, just is a different name. You generally don't sort items in a queue either, because after all, you want them displayed or you want to work with them in the order that they came in. Queue is first in, first out, which does make sense for things like shipping or serving customers. So I need to chain my show shopping cart to work with a queue instead. Now, once again, you generally wouldn't work with a for each loop with a queue. Instead, what you'll call is the dequeue method. So instead of a for each loop, I'm going to create a while loop that iterates through the items within the queue. When you dequeue something, it's actually removed from the array. So calling dequeue is like accessing the item and removing it at the same time. So as long as there's one or more items in the queue, we'll keep iterating through the while loop. Here I will extract first item from the queue. And I'll go ahead and write it to the console so that we can see it. So let's give this a shot. As you can see, it displayed the items in the exact order that I added them. The first one added was the Vista resource kit, so that was the first one displayed. First in, first out. The .NET framework provides another very similar, but kind of opposite collection type called stack. Now people who've done low-level programming will already be with the way stacks work. They're a last in, first out type of collection. Instead of calling in queue, you call push. You push things onto a stack and you enqueue them onto a queue. In the development world, stacks are used to keep track of methods that have called each other. So if method A calls method B and then method B calls method C, once method C completes, execution needs to return to method B, which is the last item added to the stack. After method B completes, execution needs to return to method A. Again, the previous item added to the stack. You wouldn't want a first in, first out type queue for that, because after method C completed, it would actually return to method A, which wouldn't be ready for it. So I need to update the show shopping cart to work with a stack instead. And as before, the while loop will work fine, but instead of calling DQ, I want to call pop. Pop removes the item from the stack. And we'll run this, and what we'll see is the items in the exact opposite order. So here, Fabricam was the last item added to the stack. It's the first one to come off. If you ever do need to view an item in the stack without removing it, you can use the peek method. It does the exact same thing as pop. It returns the item in question, but it doesn't remove it. If I were to run this now, it would just cycle forever.